Hi, my name is Vesna Karapetrova, and we're here today at Canadian Macedonian Place on the 10th of July 2014 to interview Mr. Risto Chachkirovsky. Welcome, Risto, and thank you for sharing your story with us here at the archives of the Canadian Macedonian Historical Society. We're going to conduct the interview in English, if it's okay with you. But if there are some Macedonian words or phrases you want to use, it's no problem. How do you feel about that?
Well, to begin with, I would like to say a few words in Macedonian. Just for the sake of speaking my language. Now, this is the language that we haven't had a chance to speak when we grew up. So whenever I have a chance, I always prefer to speak Macedonian language. It's not that it's patriotic, but it's a inner force, you know, that makes me feel better if I speak Macedonian, because at the end of the day, I'm proud to be a Macedonian. I'm not ashamed to speak Macedonian whenever I have the chance to do so. But English has been a language that I have learned, and I did that by myself, basically. You know, I never went to school to speak the English language. So if I kind of misplace words or misspeak, you know, in English, so please excuse me for that.
That's no problem.
Okay.
Where and when were you born, Risto?
Well, I was born in Aegean, Macedonia. That's part of the northern part of the Greece, mm-hmm. We call it Aegeiska Macedonia, in the village of Statisa. That's a Macedonian name. I learned about my village having a Greek name afterwards, you know, when I grew up back in Poland. So, but we grew up entirely speaking Macedonian, you know, among all villages. When we went to church, we had our own priest who was Macedonian, and he spoke the Macedonian language.
So, and what village was that?
Statica. In Greek name, it's Melas. Mm-hmm. That's the region of Kostur. Okay, so.
And what year were you born in?
I was born in 1940. That's during the German occupation of Macedonia at that time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's very hard, but some people do remember those years of German occupation. I would just say one thing that I remember. When the Germans came to our village, they were stationed in the center of the village, and when I was small, you know, I had a blonde hair, you know, like that, and my relatives used to call me a German, you know, because of my hair. But the question is, one of the soldiers was having his breakfast, I think, and he took a piece of bread and put some butter on it. I remember this one here because we didn't use butter at that time. And because he saw me, you know, for some reason he remembered back home, you know, his children, and he gave me a piece of that bread, you know. I remember that distinctly, you know, that what happened. So that was during that German occupation. We grew up, you know, like in all villages, you know, having to grow up not properly dressed, properly fed, because, you know, at wartime you've got just about nothing, you know, to spare.
What was different in your village in wartime? What happened?
Oh, there are many things that happened. You know, it's amazing that when you remember those stories. Mm-hmm. You know, when they came, during that, there was a fight going on, you know, and the German came to the village, and there was a German soldier killed nearby. So what they've done, they gather all the men from the village, they put them in the, you know, one beside the other, and they counted every tenth of them was supposed to be executed. But one important thing was, this is a story told by my mother, actually.
Yes.
There was, at that time, if you can recall, the Bulgarians, they were sided with the Germans. So there was a Bulgarian officer present at that time, and he managed to postpone or to eliminate that execution, you know. So that managed to get out of that, you know, trouble that the villagers got into. That's
so the Bulgarians, you would say, were
The Bulgarian officer, helped
the village people.
Yes, helped
the Macedonian
the
people in the village.
Yeah, you know, I remember this one year because, contrary to what happened there in the today's Republic of Macedonia, the Bulgarians came as occupiers. You know, they occupied the Macedonia, so the relations were quite different. So today, let's say the Republic of Macedonia does not view Bulgaria as a related country, more like a distance, you know. We feel closer with Serbia than the Bulgarian, even though it should have been all the way around, you know. Because traditionally, Macedonians feel closer to Bulgarians. Before the Bulgarians got the idea that they need to be on top of us, you know, then when things started to go wrong, basically, you know, in life, real life, and in politics as well.
Right. And Risto, were your brothers and sisters also born in Statica?
Yes. Actually, not all of them. My youngest sister was born in Poland. When we moved to Poland, my mom, she was lucky enough to be sent to Poland, so she came over there. But we were in the foster homes, you know, the orphanages, as
orphanage
we call it.
Homes,
and my mother, that's an amazing story, you know, those are war stories. She came to Poland, she didn't speak the language, she had no means of supporting herself, and they went out, you know, on their own, you know. There was something that only my mom could tell you, but she's not alive to say that, but they had struggled so much because the orphanage, the government, they took care of us, you know. We've been sent to schools, we've been fed and everything which comes with it, but not them, you know. Later on, she kind of joined us, you know, and she started helping in the kitchen, you know, and helping with in the orphanage for a short while.
Now, where were your parents born? And we'll come back to your mother. That's a very interesting story.
My parents are born in the same village. So that's Statica.
Right. And when would that be about?
That was just about in the most troublesome years for Macedonia, during the Balkan Wars. 1912. My mom and my father was just about that, 1912 or 1913, something, something of that.
Right. And you explained that, we'll just go a little bit into the chronology again. And your grandparents, were they also born in Statica as far
no,
as you know?
No, no, no. That's, you know, that when you go to the grandparents, there are four of them, you know.
Okay.
So I've got from my dad, you know, that's a grandparent. From my mother's side, he was from other village. He was in Aposkep, we call it. I don't know the Greek name, Aposkep.
Aposkep, okay.
I don't know the Greek name for it, but it was a very beautiful place. You know, it's near the city of Kostur.
Kostur, huh?
Yeah. And they have water coming out of the side of a, you know, small hill, and the water is coming in such a quantities, you know, that the people can go over there and do all their washing, they drink, you know, things like that, and it's very picturesque, you know, like that. And he was actually, they call them Popovi, you know, Pop, that's a priest in Macedonia, so they call it Popovi because one of his father was a priest in that village. So that was from my mother's side. From my father's side, he was born in my village, Statica.
Okay. And how about your grandparents?
That's what
So those are your grandparents that were so... And what language did they speak?
Well, we speak all the time the Macedonian language.
Okay. How about your uncles and aunts? Where were they born?
Well, most of them, they were born in the same village. Yes.
Statica. And again, the language they spoke?
No, no, absolutely. The only language that was spoken, it was the Macedonian. Unofficially, because, you know, everybody, since the Greeks took over Macedonia, they promoted, you know, they forbid speaking the language, you know, so they had to officially speak the Greek language. So my mother told me that they went up to the sixth grade, you know, they used to speak, they used to be taught to speak Greek. Mm-hmm. But they did that speaking in the schools, but never at home or elsewhere for that matter. So it was like they forced to learn the language, but we couldn't handle that. I mean, nobody liked to speak Greek. At our times, everybody was speaking the Macedonian language. Mm-hmm.
Risto, you shared that your mom explained to you from her life story that when she went to school, she had to speak in Greek, but outside of the school, everybody spoke Macedonian. Did you go to school as well?
Well, actually, not really, except before we left, you know, the village. That was during the civil war in Greece, you know that. So there were no official school open, except in our village, they have brought a Macedonian teacher. You know, he was the one who, you know, who spoke the language and he knew the alphabet. He was not a proper teacher, but he knew enough for a small kids, you know, to teach us, you know, like that. Mm-hmm. And that stayed for a few months before we left. For your curiosity, just I remember the way we used to learn the language, because we didn't have paper or things like that. So what we use a, there is a special piece of stone which slices, you know, like small black slices, and we took that, framed like that, and used a very stone from the river nearby, very soft one, and you could write with that on that piece of stone, and that's how we used to write, you know. So mm-hmm. That was peace. And in addition to that, that was springtime, so in order to go to school, so you have to bring to the school a piece of wood, so they could, you know, put that into the ovens so that could heat the room we were in.
So everybody had to bring their
exactly.
Their
if you
log.
Didn't if you didn't bring, you know, it was very hard. You know, the punishment was, you know, they used to mm-hmm. to have a small piece like that and you hit mm-hmm. for on your.
Do you remember head. This?
Yes, I remember that.
And the language that you were schooled
at that time. At that time, there was a Macedonian language, but I remember nothing from it. We learned almost nothing. It was a very short period of time.
So you don't remember any other schooling other than the Macedonian schooling for that short period?
Yeah.
That was so that would have been just before the civil or during the civil war.
That was during the civil war.
1948.
Yeah, it started, you know, 1946, 47, and it lasted until 1950.
So during that time, some of the villages
exactly.
had Macedonian schools.
Yes, some of them, and you know, one of the teachers who learned in that. There was Vasco Pancharovski. I don't know if you remember, but he was a very well-known activist. He was in Canadian community, Canadian Macedonian community.
Yes,
over here. And
Macedonian
he passed away.
Human
yeah,
rights,
yeah. So
he was
at age 14 made taught. You know, so he learned the language. So he was sent to teach the Macedonian language.
He so was he was teaching you. In,
not me.
Or
not
in
me.
Another school in another village.
Another place. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And Risto, how big was your village? How many people were there in your recollection when you were, before you left?
I don't know. How many? I think we were something like 80, 100 maybe houses mm-hmm. that would bring families, you know, and maybe less than that. Something like 100 and maybe 120 houses. Really, we're quite a number, you know. It was quite a big village at that time. Mm-hmm. But I don't know the exact number.
Right. And do you remember anything of your friends when you were growing up?
Well,
and the games you played?
We actually, all the most of the memories that I have from that period of time, they're all in my head, you know, I remember all of them. Okay. What we play a game called Bishka. That's a very close to the today's golfing, you know, like that. But it's slightly different, you know. There was everybody had a small hole in the ground, and everybody had a stick, and you call the stick in the hole, so you guard that, you know, like that. But there was Bishka, there was one free, and they used to keep a can, you know, brought to resemble sort of ball, you know, around, and he used to kick that. So if he kicked that can, and the can kicked you, so you became the bishkar. You know, bishkar is the one who looks after the pits, you know.
After the pit keeper.
That's exactly. So that's how we play that. And also we call it, the other game was cleanser, we call it. You know, there was a small piece.
Cleanser?
Cleanser, yeah. That small piece of stick like that, cut 45 degrees on both ends, and with the stick, when you hit it on that, that lifts itself up, and then you hit it like that. And there was a running around. So we play that game.
Like baseball almost.
Something like that. We could quite a game, you know. Yeah, that. And many other games, you know, like the girls, they play pupalki, they call it, you know. Like five of them, you know, small stones. And they lift one and they spread and they collect it one at a time, then two, then three, then all of them, you know, and if you miss it up, you go kicked out, you know, things like that. Mm-hmm. And other games as well, you know, so as a kid, there was a very advanced, you know, like a social life at that time.
Yes.
The social life, that included all the religious activities.
Like celebrations.
Like celebrations, kolenda, what, you know, like Vodici and every, all those celebrations that we had, you know, and I remember them, like Kolenda, we used to go, you know.
Kolenda?
Yeah, Kolenda.
Kolenda?
Yeah.
What do you remember with those celebrations?
That we played with the children, we had a fire in the center of, in one fire, we used to
a
jump
bonfire.
Over, yeah, and things like that. After that, we went from house to house, and every lady of the house, she had to obliged, you know, because they're yelling sometimes nasty things, you know, that so she has to yell, so she throw some nuts onto them or some small pieces of bread or fruit or everything else until, you know, they're gone away. So they went from house to house and we did that.
Like Halloween almost, right?
Yeah, it's in a way, except that tradition lasted in Macedonia for just about over 500 years. During that Turkish occupation of the Macedonia.
It's still here.
And it was, you know, I've learned that in history, that basically that was Byzantium, you know, at that time before the Turks came, that was the longest lasting civilization which stayed, you know, kept its level of
tradition.
Economy, tradition, everything just stagnant. It didn't grow up. That was one of the best periods of that region. And when the Turks came, you know, they left all the tradition, you know, intact. And it's today, you know, even though today we didn't quite like Turkish because they occupied Macedonia for 550 years, you know, exactly. But because of, they tolerated our Macedonian people, they didn't do quite as much damage as the Greeks did with a short period of time they were present in Macedonia. So today, you know, like the saying goes, you know, you're enemy, you know, it's when you've got the same enemy that makes you friends, you know. So today in the Macedonian politics, that's what's happening. The Macedonians are very friendly with the Turkish, and you know, that's more to the story than meets the eye, but basically that's what it is. You know, the Turks like, because of the Muslim minority we have over there, so they are interested, but regardless of that, they're investing in Macedonia, they're friends, you know, they're helping Macedonia in many instances, internationally and internally, or in the Balkans, you know, so that's amazing, you know, fact how the politics can make sometimes, you know, from the enemies makes friends, you know.
That's, yes.
That was, you know, kind of a comment beyond your interview, I suppose.
Yeah, no, that's a very good comparison bringing it to the present. So, Kolede is celebrated around Christmas time,
yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Do you remember any other celebrations, like weddings, or that are in your, you know, in your mind still?
Oh, yeah. Well, basically, in the village, all the weddings were done for everybody. Everybody was invited to begin with.
The whole village?
The whole village. And it was done in the center of the village. We've got a place when you, and there, or with the dances and things like that, you know. They go, you know, the tradition like with the pigs, and then there was the tradition with carrying the flag, you know, going. And the other thing, like, for example, what was it? I remember at the holidays at home when we did, my mom, she used to attach, you know, whether it was an apple or an egg, you know, to a string like that, and it was went around, whoever could bite it without touching it, using hands, you know, like that. That was one of the traditions, you know, that coming there. Mm-hmm. And it was, I remember that weddings that were in the center, because happened at one time during the dancing, they were close to the river, and there was a lady who fell into the water. You know. So that I remember. But everybody was invited, everybody attended, you know, and there was, you know, a reason to celebrate for just about everybody in the village.
And the songs and the dances?
Oh, they were all Macedonian dancing, you know, songs and dances, and with the priest on top of that. We've got our priest from our own village. Mm-hmm. He was a Macedonian priest, and he used to service the neighboring villages as well, because there were not too many, you know, like that. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, Risto, how old were you when you had to leave your village?
I was 8 years old.
And you are one of the Deca Begalci. Yeah. And what do you remember about the exodus of how you left your village?
Well, first of all, to begin with, the idea of taking the children out of the war theater, they call it today, it's a modern word for that, in order to save them from you know, from being get killed, because the bombings that went, it was, you know, like every bombing, you know, they do not recognize whether it's a child, a woman, or a soldier down when they throw those bombs, you know, on top of that. So in order to save that from the atrocity of the war, they decided to move the children out. That was the action taken by the Red Cross. And today the Red Cross was contribute to that, but they were pointed out as a deciding factor in that area. Besides that, that was an action which was accepted by the, at that time, by the communist countries, you know. So that's why most of the Deca Begalci, the children refugee, were taken from that theater, let's say, from the war zone, they've taken to those countries, like Romania, let's say, Czechoslovakia, Poland, and Hungary. I think basically in those countries, you know, they were divided, you know, there were about 28,000 children. Mm-hmm. They were divided, you know, batches of 4,000 or 5,000, you know, and they were sent, you know, like that. And what I remember, those are the worst things that you could remember. In order to get away from the fighting areas, we had to travel at night to begin with, and they were small children. Mm-hmm. We were, my older sister, she was, I think she was 13. My brother, he was something like 12, I was 8. And I've got a smaller brother who was 6 at that time. And I remember traveling that because my brother was holding, actually we were holding to my sister's skirt, you know, so we don't get loose. Some of the children got lost during that period of time. But what they divided us, and also they assigned an older person, usually it was either one of the mothers, you know, for the children, or they were separated, some older, you know, to look after us until we got into the places. We went like that. As I said, we were traveling during the nights, because during the day they were bombing all around, so we were hidden, you know, like that. Then we crossed the border. At that time there was the border with then Yugoslavia. Actually, we went into the Macedonia.
Right, and if we can just back up a little bit, your parents, your mother and your father, where were they when you were being taken away?
Well, actually, they were with the partisans. They were actively fighting, you know, with the Greek government forces.
So, can you tell us a little bit about that conflict?
Yeah, that conflict, basically what happened is, well, you have to know there is one thing it's not properly reflected or in the telling the story about the war. The war was started basically by the Macedonians, because we had notions that we're going to get our country for us, for Macedonians. We're going to get the rights. Finally, we're going to get united, the Macedonian people around, because, you know, we've been divided artificially. Well, the borders were not. So the Macedonians, they didn't like the idea when that was awarded to Greeks, that was stopped, and we didn't get our rights. Mm-hmm. And in Greek Macedonia, you know, that it's called, nowadays we call it genocide, but the question is, that's what happened. They have changed all our personal names. They have changed all the topographic names. They have forbidden using the language as such. And, you know, those things, you know, when you put them together, that's what the genocide today is called. You know, and in addition to that, they kind of supervised that. There were people paid, you know, to spy on us. If they heard you, or, you know, they went as far as to listen behind your windows or doors. So if you spoke a Macedonian language inside, they come and take you away. There's quite a few people, you know, it's been documented. They've sent them away. Not just send them away. They've taken them from Macedonia and they resettled them into the southern part of Greece. I don't know if you remember my friend Vasco Pancharski, I mentioned before, he was telling me a story about how one couple from Macedonia went, you know, to Crete, there is that one of the biggest Greek islands, to work during the summertime. And they went to a restaurant to have a meal, you know, and they've noticed a couple sitting in the corner and they were looking at them, you know. They were looking, and finally they decided to communicate. What appears, they were Macedonians sent to Crete because they have spoken the Macedonian language at home. So that's how it happened. That's how I know it was. So in that, going back to the war, to your, answering to a question, yes. Our people went to the war, they initiated, they taken part because they wanted to get some basic human rights, or in other words, a bigger autonomy for the Macedonians, if not uniting with the Macedonians. That was, but the question is, at that time in Macedonia, if you follow the history, after the Balkan Wars, there was a movement on the Balkans. There were about, I don't know the numbers now, you can talk to historians, but there were about 300,000 to about 600,000 Macedonians that moved to Bulgaria, because at that time, they said, you know, we've got good relations. Bulgarians, they wanted to take part of the Macedonia for themselves. So there was the tendency for them to accept Bulgarians. They went to Bulgaria. In their places, the Greeks, they have brought in Greece from Turkey, the Christian from Turkey, and they brought them into the Greeks, into the Greece, but locate them in Macedonia. The idea was for them to denationalize, to change the number of people living in the Aegean Macedonia, so they can later claim that the Greek majority is bigger than Macedonia, so they will claim it as their own.
Yes.
So take our rights for that. So that was a play of things, you know, that happened at that time. And the Greeks, they took part in it in order, as one of the leaders, one of the general of that, he came to visit at one time when we were in Poland. That's what he explained to us, you know. They wanted to keep the Macedonia in Greek. I don't know if you recall, I'll give you an example for that matter. There was a general, Marcos.
Yeah, can you just tell us the exchange that you talked about, what year it was when Macedonians went in to Bulgaria?
That was, I think that was after the Balkan Wars, mm-hmm. And that was, I think the process was more active in 20s, at the beginning of
20s. Beginning of 1920s,
20,
yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Before I forget, I give you an example about the General Marcos. He was one of the top generals in the partisan, you know, fighting the, and he was taken into the Russia, and after that he was accepted. There was a change of hearts in Greeks, you know, they accepted those partisan communists, because Greeks are kind of a crazy people, sorry about that, you don't quote me on that. But the question is, they have given them, you know, the how do you call it?
Ponti?
No, they accepted, you know, when somebody gets, you forgive
refugee?
No, no.
Amnesty.
Amnesty.
They gave amnesty.
Exactly. And that general, he was coming to Greece, and he made a stop in Macedonia, in Struga. He was over there. He went over there to relax, you know, to get well. And there were two journalists, Greeks, that learned about it. They came to ask him. And the question was to him, see, what did you do with your partisan affairs, you know, like that? How, you know, how do you explain that? And those are the words of the general, and he says, General Marcus, he says, we've done what we've done, but he said, but we have achieved one thing, we have kept the Macedonian to be Greek. Okay, so that was the interpretation as to what really went into that war. The Greeks went into it, and most of them were those one coming from Asia, as I mentioned before, from Turkey.
Yes.
And those were the ones who took part in that.
In the partisan war?
Partisan war, and those are the ones who were the worst part of that war, you know, in that civil war in Greece.
So the Macedonian partisan joined the Greek Communist Party?
Oh yeah, they've been fighting together, you know.
Because?
Because, yeah, that's what it is. Because Macedonia wanted freedom for them, and the Greeks, they wanted to be part of that so they don't get the freedom. But that's my interpretation when you interpret the facts of what happened on the over there. There were many things like that. My uncle told me when the partisans, Macedonians, when at the end of the war they wanted to cross over to Macedonia, and here it was. And now I'm telling you, that was my uncle, my wife's father, brother. Okay? And he says, the Greek officer came at the border, and he took his pistol, his pistol, yeah, a revolver, whatever it is, and he put into the mouth of the Macedonian, usually that was either Macedonian or Yugoslav border officer, and he says, close the border, let the people go back, or I'm going to shoot you down. So that was one of the ideas, as I what I to explain it to what really went on. The idea was, since the inception of the Greece in 1830, to denationalize, to eliminate the Macedonians, you know, from majority into the small minority in Greece. About that majority, I remember, sorry if I speak,
no,
you know. The question is, I've had, when I came to Canada, there was one friend, when the Vomarol came to power, there was one came over here, and they went with a person who was related. He took a Macedonian from my village wife. We've spoken to him, and he had a Bulgarian printed in Bulgaria a book, and it was in, I think it was 1905. There was how do you call it, they measured, they ask people their nationality and make
survey.
Survey.
Or census.
Census. Census. Sorry about that, my English,
no,
you know,
okay.
Sometimes I think in Macedonian and speaking English, it's very difficult.
Yeah.
Well, in that census at that time, and it was done, by the way, by the League of Nations at that time, because there were not United Nations, League of Nations was at that time. And what happens? The majority of the people in Macedonia were Macedonians, speaking the Macedonian language, declaring themselves to be Macedonians. There were something like, I don't know the exact numbers, it was something like 60% or that nature. The Greeks were reminder, you know, they were very small, so half of that or even less than that, because there were Albanian element coming into the play over here. And you see, at that time, the Macedonians were the majority in the Macedonia. And after the exchange of people that I just mentioned, they have changed that you know, that.
Yes,
in
1905, this census showed the majority
the
Macedonian. Were Macedonian.
Yeah.
That's right. And Risto, that was very interesting what you said about Marcos saying that you know, to eliminate the Macedonians was the goal from Greece. So, would you say that he was against the Macedonians all along?
Actually, not against, because you know, it's very hard to defined, you know, against, you know, sometimes you like things, you don't like things, you know, but say that he was in his heart a Greek who wanted to keep Greece as big as possible. And if that means that he would take some rights from the Macedonian people, he would do that.
But that's not.
But then he
said.
Had to accept some of it. Mm-hmm. Some of it he accepted because he came, you know, when we were in Poland, he came. At that time I was in the high school. I was in the last year of high school, and he came to speak to us from Russia. They sent him over here, you know. And we have asked him, you know, like that, and we have asked him about Macedonia, and as far as he said that no way we could let Macedonia go by itself. And I remember at that time, because we were, you know, I was that about 16 years old, and I started to think about nationalities and politics, you know, to understand. And there were about six children like myself who disliked that, and you know, they how they called when you they whistled. They whistled. And at that time the principal of that orphanage was a Greek. He noted those, and can you imagine what happened? Because of that manager or that principal, you know, was a Greek, he took those six people, they sent two of them out of the orphanage into the Polish orphanage, around to other cities, because they booed. So
yeah.
That explains, answers your question about him being whatever he was. That's what he says at that time. He says, I've done what I've done, but we've managed to keep Macedonia Greek. And that was not just my saying so. That was in the magazine of Macedonia. And it was a historian, Macedonian Christoph, Christo Andonov, I think. Mm-hmm. And he was the one who put that in the newspaper. He was the one. So it is true. I did not invent that, you know.
No, but when the Macedonians joined the Communist Party with Marcos to fight, then that means that they joined with without really knowing what was...
Yeah.
Behind the Communist Party of Greece.
It's very hard. It was very hard to define things like that, you know. Even today, historians have mixed emotions, mixed ideas as to what happened, you know. The way it was developed, it's kind of a very hard, you know. We can talk about it for a long time, you know, and you will never get to the real answers to the question.
Right. So, Risto, you started to recollect the Exodus, the way it was in at night time. Were the villages being bombed during the day?
Yes.
Did you experience?
Well, actually, I did. I remember that sitting on the balcony. You know, we got balconies over there, and there were the government forces on one side. There is mountains on both sides. On the other side, there were partisans, and you could see the flying. You know going, you know, that because at night you could see the traces of the going. So we've seen that, and there was bombing not in our village, not in particular, but I've heard about other ones being bombed, you know, like that. So that's. Mm-hmm.
And in what country did you flee to?
Basically, that was the closest. We went from when we crossed the border, we went to Macedonia, which was then in Yugoslavia, and. We stayed there. That was amazing, you know. Lubo, you know, that was the village that we've been taking to. And the villagers, they divided us children into the houses. So they've taken us, they fed us, you know, they gave us everything they could. They cleaned up, you know, because, you know, if you remember at that time, you know, that children were traveling, not eating, and there was all sorts of sickening things going on. I don't want to mention that because today we look, you know, awful. But they've taken care of us, they cleaned us, you know, they fed us, and we stayed there for about, I don't know, for a day, 2 weeks, I don't know, I don't remember well. Then they sent us to the city of Bitola. Mm-hmm. So we stayed there a very short period of time. And then from there they divided us, put us into the trains, and sent us. We went from there to Romania, mm-hmm. And there was, you know, you should see that we were traveling into the those wagons, which were for transferring the farm animals. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, because you know that was an illegal action, doing that. So they packed us into those wagons, you know, and they send us, you know, through the borders like that, you know, so they don't take a note, you know. That was kind of weird, but we've managed to get. We went to Romania at that time, from our village, and we were in Romania about 7-8 months.
Okay, and when did you leave? It was 1948. And
that's why we celebrated the refugee children in 1988. We celebrated, yes, 4 years of that.
And so about what month was the exodus?
We went in March.
March.
Mm-hmm. From our village in March we went. So from the March we went, you know, through that was a very short period of time. So in October, mm-hmm, I think we left Romania. So you can see that about 8 months. Eight months.
Were your brothers and sisters with you all along?
Yeah, at that time we were
together.
Mm-hmm. In our cases we were together. So when we went, then from there we went to Poland.
Right, and where was your mother?
Oh, she was fighting. She was fighting the war.
She was part of the.
Yeah, for the movement, you know.
For, so she was, yeah, with the partisans.
With the partisans.
And
yeah.
Your father?
Yeah, and he was partisan at that time.
He was partisan, yeah, there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, you know, that's how we went to Poland. Then my mother then came to Poland, you know, when the war was over. My father was killed, you know, at the end of the war.
Almost
at the
end.
Was killed at the
during
end.
During the war, oh, okay.
Yeah. And actually, my father, my two uncles, you know, that's that.
Sorry.
And I had a smaller brother, the smallest, he was killed also in the village, you know. Because my mom at that time, she said, well, I'm going to keep one child with me, you know. Well, that was it. That one child was killed by a horse, you know. That the partisan, I think they were, or the government, you know, kick him, you know, like that, you know. The children played and he was killed. So, you know, the war is a war, you know. You've got, mm-hmm, plenty of people being.
So while you and your other brothers and, yeah, sisters escaped,
yeah,
your mother stayed in the village with your brother.
Well,
your,
yeah,
brother.
No, in the village were my grandparents over there. So he said, my mom, she was helping, you know,
with the partisans. Yes.
And, you know, like women, they didn't actively fight, but they had to dig the
holes, and
the halls, you know, the
tunnels
and things like that. And they were bringing food, you know, and all sorts of things associated with that.
Helping,
you know,
the soldiers.
Or helping the soldier, you know. Mm-hmm. So that was part of the business, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And your brother died as a result of,
yeah, yeah, being, because of that, being there, you know, that, mm-hmm, horse, you know, kick him, you know, like that when they played like that.
Mm-hmm.
And kick him in the head, you know, and he's got,
mm-hmm, yeah, killed, yeah. Now, Risto, when you landed in Poland, what do you remember about how your life progressed with,
well,
the other children?
Well, I don't know if you can remember. I remember one thing when we went over there. First of all, now they separated us. They separated by age. It's not how they are really age, but how do they look? So if you look, they were tall, they were older. So they separated us. My family, my sister went to one, my brother, I elsewhere, the smaller one, somewhere else.
So
that
in
was
different homes.
So different
Poland,
homes.
Different cities too?
No, it was, at the beginning it was one city.
Mm-hmm. And what city was that?
Lądek-Zdrój, it was called. It was a place for when the Germans, actually that was the territory you owned before the Second World War by the Germans, and it was the very well kept, like a village, and it was for a holiday. The Germans used to come over there, spend their holiday, so it was very well kept and, you know, done like that. So we stayed over there. And then there was given some Polish people to look after us. I'll, mm-hmm, tell you one small story about that too, you know. Like when we came from that, I had a pants with a hole on the knees.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The hole in the, we call it dupka, you know.
Yes.
Like a hole. The question is, in Polish, dupka, it's the the how do they call it,
the rear.
Okay, the rear. And there was a lady, you know, she said, "What is it?" And they start laughing, you know, like that. Uh-huh. Later they explained to me why they were laughing. And that lady, for some reason, because of I was taking part in the dancing group they organized, mm-hmm. and she liked me so much, you wouldn't believe that. And when she got married, she went home, you know, like that. And after a few years, she came specially to the orphanage where we were in different place to come and to see me because she like that, you know. Mm-hmm. But the question was, when you grow into orphanage, you know, there are different circumstances when you go like that. When we are growing up, when you see a lady, you know, at that time was, say, they call it Zhenkar in Macedonia. Mm-hmm. It's like womanizer or something
womanizer,
like that.
Yeah.
And that was the worst thing that could attach to you.
Mm-hmm.
And she came, and we were playing, you know, those
marbles.
Playing, and she came to look, you know, at me. She was looking, waiting over there. I look at her, and we smiled to each other. But I couldn't go because the friends will call me a womanizer, you know,
uh-huh.
like that. And she stayed there for a while, and then she left.
Okay.
You know, so in orphanage, things like that they develop, you know. And there is one thing my brother maybe will know better. You know, when my mother came. When she was given the right to look after it, she was working in the kitchen and things like that. At that time, in Yugoslavia, under the Tito, they went bizarre. They went disagreed with Russia, Stalin at that time.
Yes.
So they went from friends into enemies. And because of that, you know, there were Greeks at that time on top of things when we were over there. And they saw my mom, they called her the Titoids, they call it. And they branded her as a spy for the Tito, because, you know, we've got some relatives, you know, like that. When they used to read our letters, so they knew what's happening. And she was kicked out of the orphanage, and she went on her own, out in the world, you know, not speaking the language, without any, nothing, you know, like that. And in addition to that, what happened, they went on to check on my brother. He was a very good student, you know, a smart cookie for his age. And they went to check his books, what he was reading, and he had some books, you know, from Stalin, and who knows, at that time, whatever, he could do that. I learned later on, I didn't connect that. There was a Greek teacher who was with us, and he came to me, and he inspected everybody has a box, you know, like that many cube things. He came to me and checked my box, you know, and I also I had a few books over there, unlike, you know, other kids who were, you know, I like reading, you know. He came to check my books and like that.
To see if you
exactly
were also,
to see, and they wanted they wanted to kick my brother out of the orphanage as well, but somehow the Polish people, they were smarter than that, you know, so they kept you know things like that. But this is a whole sort of experiences coming with that.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned to you a while about me speaking the language, the Macedonian preferred.
Yes.
You know, at one time when I finished the high school, I went to the university, I was coming home, and I was going back to the city with the train. And at that time, I got to know my wife, you know, so we were traveling. And we were speaking, you know, Macedonian. There was, in that same background, there was some Greeks traveling that we knew before when we were growing up. And one of them came to me and he says, "Why don't you come sit with us, you know? We can speak Greek, you know, it's like a friend's." I told him, "I can come up there, but can you speak Macedonian as well, you know?"
Mm-hmm.
The question is, they never learn to speak Macedonian.
Yes,
they never learn to speak Macedonian, but we had to learn to speak Greek.
Exactly, that was my central question. While you were in the orphanage homes, what language were you educated in?
So that's what it is. As I started mentioning that, the idea was that with the Macedonians, you know, because the Greeks were the dominant force whether they were teachers, you know, that's coming from the, it was coming from the Greek Communist Party. Those are the same people that General Marcos and the other were coming on top, sitting on top and trying to keep their ideas of Greeks, Macedonians being Greeks before they could be anything else. So they, with the Macedonians, we had to, sometimes we learn Macedonian and Greek. The Greeks only learned the Greek language, you know. It was short.
So you were in the same classes as the Greek children, but for Macedonians, you went and learned Macedonian and the Greeks didn't come with you?
Sometimes they separated Macedonians one class and the Greeks were the other class.
Yes.
So they don't necessarily went to the same class. So it was a different, mm-hmm. with the exception that, you know, before the Tito changed sides, we used to, you know, when they, you know, when we learned the language Macedonian, actually it was not totally a Macedonian language. There was a Bulgarian alphabet and words taken, and they were forced upon us, you know, that to learn that. And there was a teacher who was actually a few years older than me. He didn't know much about it, you know. So that was not actually, you know, it was one or 2 hours a week, you know, so that was not much, you know, of a language
learning. Right.
So, and after the Tito, you know, when the things changed, we changed to the Yugoslavian. Well, we started with that language that we speak, so when the Tito changed, they changed it to Bulgarian, you know, that's how it went.
Mm-hmm.
But we learned, so we speak Macedonian and Greek, and the Greeks only Greek, you know, like that.
Mm-hmm.
That was the language that was spoken. And normally, it was beneficial to appoint to Macedonians because the more language you speak, you know, as they say, you know, the more access you've got to the knowledge to books and experiences and things like that. But that doesn't apply to Greeks. They still, you know, like kind of a one-sided, you know, kind of.
Yes. So that was something that you remember very much, that the Greeks did not learn Macedonian.
Oh yeah. That's and many other things. You know, it's very hard. You know, the teacher that came to inspect my things, you know, like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, when I went to the university, I remember going, and when I saw him coming, because he was living in the same village, I crossed over to the other side of the street to avoid him. And he, you know, he went all the way to my mother. He says, "Why your son doesn't like me anymore?"
Mm-hmm. Right.
Never learned the lesson, they never will.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the Greeks.
And so tell us about your mom and how you reunited with your mom. She was kicked, she was actually fired from,
from the orphanage,
orphanage home. And what happened after?
Well, she had, she found a friend, the two of them. They went to another city, they went to a factory, you know, to work as a laborers, you know. And what happened with her was when she got the holidays, she would take the trains and she would buy small things like caramels, you know, or a piece of a rubber ball, you know, like that. And she would go from one city to another to visit every child, you know, she had. And then she went to work and she spent all the money over there. So she kept with nothing going over there. So that was her way. And actually, we didn't get to live with my mother until I graduated from the university.
And when was that?
Oh, that was, I graduated in 1964.
So you stayed in Poland until 1964?
I stayed 1966.
Yes.
After 2 years, I applied and was accepted then at that time by Yugoslavia and went to Macedonia.
Mm-hmm. But in terms of your mother, you were separated from her right from 1948?
Yeah. Until the 1964 when we finished the university, when mm-hmm. we went. So, but you know, at that time we were going to visit my mom, you know, she was close by, you know.
You could see her from time
to
time.
Yeah, I could see, because she couldn't bear to stay away, you know, so she always camped herself close by, you know, with us, with mm-hmm. some of the children, you know, like that.
Mm-hmm. So when and where did you reunite with all your siblings and your mother?
Well, basically, never did as a family, because when we grown up, you know, after the I finished the university, then I got married, you know, so I got my own separate, you know.
So this was in Poland?
Yeah. Well, yeah, actually, yeah, I got married in Poland. My first firstborn child was born in Poland. Mm-hmm. And so did my brother. He was, you know, also married over there, and my older sister, you know. So, but, you know, we were coming and visiting my mom at that time. Sometimes we stayed over there during the holidays like that. But we never lived together as a family. Mm-hmm. After 1948, when we left, that was it.
And how, and so tell us about going back to Macedonia. What motivated you to go to Macedonia?
Well, motivation. First of all, when we went over there, we kept, with the Matica of Veselenici, it was at that time, you know, that was the institution in government of Macedonia who took care, should have taken care of immigrants. So we wrote letter to them, explain who we are, so they were nice and they send us books in Macedonian. That was very nice thing at that time, you know, to get some books. They send us some players,
record players
mm-hmm. in Macedonian, and that was a holiday for us over there, you know, at that time. So, and because of doing so, I remember, you know, we applied, me and my brother, because we were kind of initiated for our family. We sent a letter to the government. Mm-hmm. At that time, we were in the high school. Will you imagine, in the high school, we sent already, we wanted to go to Macedonia. They sent us a letter, said, guys, you first finish your high school, then apply to come to Macedonia. Mm-hmm. The question is, we did that. We finished the high school. My brother, it was 1 year ahead of me. But by the time we went over there, we went to the university. Now they said, guys, finish the university. Then you come,
yes.
Sent another. At the same time, just for the curiosity, how things are being developed. At the same time, Bulgaria opened its border for Macedonia. Whoever wanted to come, the border was open. They can go. Just sign up, whether you've got relatives or you interest, like, they accept it. I got quite a few friends of mine who accepted the idea and they went to Bulgaria. Mm-hmm. But we were a different kind. We didn't like Bulgarian, you know, to go. We wanted to go to the Macedonia because there was a country over there. There was a nation, there was a language, a culture, you know, that's so different. Because Bulgarians, they dismissed after the, you know, the Dimitrov and company went away when they eliminated the Macedonian rights, Macedonian people rights over there. And that was it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So while you were in Poland, Risto, you finished your, you arrived in Poland about the age of 8, right?
Yeah.
And all this time you were in the orphanage homes.
Yeah.
Finishing, like, how did your schooling go? You finished your grade 8 and...
Yeah, well, basically, as you go, except, you know, that was a different story in Poland. You know, sometimes we make two years in one place, then they moved us to another place when we went to another. So we've been traveling all over the place because as the Polish people, they learn of us being in Poland, they were not very, very fond of it because, you know, at that time after the war, the Poland as a country was very poor to begin with. Mm-hmm. And they, when they saw us having, you know, being fed and dressed up and taught, you know, like that, they didn't quite like the idea. So they moved us from places to places in order to quell them, you know, to, so, yeah. So that's how I've done. So I went to finish the public school, you know, it was up to the seventh grade. And the seventh grade I finished, actually, it was in one place on a big city, Szczecin it was. It was Stettin during Germans. So I went over there and I went to the high school over there in that big city. And I finished that, I think it was, 11th grade.
From grade 11. Were other Macedonian kids with you?
Well, actually, yeah, they continued their education. First of all, everybody has a chance to get their education. Everybody, no exception. So everybody has to finish the public school. The question is, only the better students, they were given chance to go to the high school. The lesser ones, they were given the... colleges or trade schools
mm-hmm.
like that. So I was a good student, so they given me the chance to go to the high school. In that high school, just happened, there were me and a friend of mine, actually a Greek, you know. Now, I used to call him friend, but later on it appeared that he was not such a friend, you know. when he went to the university, he didn't know where to go, so he joined me to go to the architecture. We studied, you know, the civil engineering. So he came. I've learned at one time that he went on to tell our friends, because there were two of us. To our friends, he says, well, that he's Greek, that I'm Macedonian, that we don't like each other, that we should be, you know, like that. And a friend of mine explained to me what was it about. So after he graduated, that was it. I mean, I've never spoken to him ever, you know, about that, because people get touchy about this one. Mm-hmm. And he was, you know, and he was the same thing. He would one time, he went to me, he says, let's speak Greek so the Polish students would not understand. I said, they do not understand Macedonian as well. Speak Macedonians if you want to. Actually, he did. He learned to speak some Macedonian. He was one of the few people who learned a few words in Macedonian. Mm-hmm. He was intelligent, you know. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's...
So you finished your university?
I finished my university.
Civil engineering?
Yeah, and that was in 1964. And then I went to live with my mom for about 2 years. I was living there until until we got accepted in 1964. That's when I graduated, and we were sent another letter to the Yugoslavian embassy, and they accepted us. So, okay, now it's time we take you. So we've accepted us. So in 1966, we moved to Macedonia.
And that was you and your mom?
Actually, it doesn't go that simple. Actually, it was accepted me and my brother. My sister stayed in Poland, and my younger brother stayed in Poland. Because, you know, they kind of owned it, because my brother was a doctor, me the engineer, so they figured out, well, those are the guys we want, you know, they kind of will contribute, you know, positive. But later, and I was living at that time with my mom, so I think later, my mom came later as well. She stayed there, and later we applied, you know, we said to them, you know, send us our family.
So initially you and your brother went to Macedonia,
yeah.
And then your mom came.
Yeah.
And
my,
your other siblings?
And the other, my younger brother, my sister, she married a Polish fellow. Mm-hmm. And she stayed there longer until they divorced, you know, they separated. They separated, actually, they were not divorced. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there are some problems. You know, when you have a different nationalities like that, usually sooner or later problems are coming unless you are willing to solve them properly at the proper time, you know. If you let small things try to prevail and they grow up to be a problem, and then the problem grows, you know, like that. So that's normal that goes in a family between the two people, you know, when they grow apart. Yeah.
Right. So when and how did you come to Canada from Macedonia?
Well, that was another story. It seems like first of all, let me tell you one story about that. Here in Canada, I've got about 12 first cousins. We are in Canada. First cousin meaning, you know, they are very close related. So quite a few were over here. So the idea was that if you want to do something, we will do that. But then the initiative was taken by my brother, you know. He came first to Canada.
And when you were in Macedonia, what did you do?
Yeah, I was working in a design office for the as an engineer. I designed for about 8 years. Pelagonia, there was one of the biggest companies, you know, in construction companies in Macedonia. Mm-hmm. And that was interesting things, you know, as the life goes on. When I was working for a job, I went to the Pelagonia, you know, I usually go to the technical director, you know, like that. And I went to him to speak. Can you imagine? There was a Polish engineer being a technical director of Pelagonia. And not just a Polish engineer. He was a grandchild to one of the biggest Polish writers. Like that. And when I went over there and I spoke to him, you know, and he right away, when he saw me that I was coming from Poland, we started speaking Polish, and we became, as a matter of fact, friends afterwards. So he hired me, and I've been hired after 2 months when I came to Macedonia. So I was lucky in that time. In contrary to my brother, he had problems, you know. When he came as a doctor, you know, he couldn't get employment, you know, because I don't want to go into the details why it happens, but that's what happened. So I got first...
You were very lucky.
Lucky? Well, and, you know, luck, it's, you're right about being lucky, but sometimes it takes much more to luck, you know. To be lucky, you have to be at the right time, right place, you know, things like that,
exactly.
And other things coming together. But regardless, I'll accept as lucky, and I start working over there, and, you know, I've been accepted. I've got friendly people. Our people are very, very good when it comes to this one. I've got no problem, with the exception there was one fellow over there who was, you know, like, he liked to talk a lot, but he was not too much. And he was complaining about us people from Aegean Macedonia getting... when we came, they were given, they had to give us, you know, a place to live, you know, and to work, you know, like that. And he says, you got people from elsewhere, and you got all those things, you know, we, the natives here, we don't have it, like that. And he started, you know, screaming like that. And I, at one time, I told him, listen, guy, when you say this and us, you have to remember one thing, that you and me, we are the same people. We share the same language, the same culture, the same country, even though divided. So when you swear and you say bad words about myself, I said, you do it to yourself as well. Well, but that was the only thing that I expected. Afterwards, he didn't change his way of thinking, but whenever he was saying something, he turned away and said, Risto, sorry, I didn't mean that. So he was basically, even though he was like, he was good. So I was accepted well, you know, I had the job, you know, that, and I got my apartment, even though it was small, but the family was growing up, so my brother decided to try to Canada because he was, at that time he got, after a few months, he got, you know, employed by, in the emergency, you know, but, you know, that's, working in the emergency over there, it's a very difficult, you know, thing. Like that, go to the villages, and sometimes you have to respond to the Albanian, you know, the Shqiptarians, we call it Albanian people, which I have nothing against, but the question is their ways of doing, because of their religion, because of their beliefs and things like that, they are entirely different people. You know, you cannot just relate to them and do things. And he explained to me it was very difficult. Mm-hmm. Well, he came to Canada, but the question is, in Canada, then again, the doctors, like everybody else, has a very hard way trying to get your degree back. So they had to put so many exams extra like that. He stayed here for a while, he couldn't work here, so he went to New Brunswick. In New Brunswick they had, they didn't have enough doctors, so they let people like my brother to work over there. So he worked over there and he tried to pass the exam, but he couldn't, he was not given the time. So he had no choice, but he applied here to the East York General Hospital, and they told him that they did not have an opening, so they said, we'll notify you if you get one. So he moved, he came back to Macedonia. Then he, then there was an opening, they called him, so he came back, you know, kind of. Mm-hmm. It was his story. So when he came here, then I decided then I'll move around here as well. I've got two-bedroom apartment, but it was very too small.
So you came,
yeah,
your brother sponsored you?
No, because of him. Actually, my brother-in-law sponsored me.
Your brother-in-law?
Yeah.
So you had gotten married in the meantime?
Oh, yeah. I had.
When did you get married?
No, I got married in Poland after I graduated, you know.
Okay.
So
yes,
I got,
you mentioned you met your wife. Can you tell us a little about that?
Oh, it's, we grew up together, you know,
in
those
orphanages.
Yeah, so we know each other, you know, we know just about everybody, you know, everybody. That's why when we got organized, there's a Begalci with that association, you could see that just about everybody knows everybody, you know. When we went from Poland, we know just about, because, you know, by moving around, we knew just about everybody, you know, on that.
Okay.
So we met over there. Actually, I started doing that because at the high school, you know, I never went to a dance, you know. I never went dance. I didn't know how to dance. And there was, at the last year of high school, there was, you know, the ball, they call it, you know.
Graduation.
And I didn't know how to dance. And I asked my wife, can you teach me? And she knew how to do it. So she taught me, you know, by teaching, then I got to know how, you know, pose her like that. And that's how I got to know her, you know. She taught me well.
Oh, yes. And then you got married?
Yeah, I got married. My son was born in Poland, and then we moved to Macedonia. Then my daughter was born in Skopje, in Macedonia. And, well, they started going to school over there in Macedonia. So when we came to Canada, you know, they were kind of in disadvantage because of the not speaking the language. But then that language, you know, that became a story because, you know, I never went to school to learn the English language. Even today, I have to think hard to find a proper English word, you know, for it, because I didn't go to school like that. In addition to that, my problem is that I think in Macedonian and speak in English, and there's a no-no. You cannot speak properly the language if you don't think in that language, you know. So right now I'm speaking at home in Macedonian all the time, so I have difficulties even now, you know, after so many years, you know, to adapt to that English speaking.
And when you came to Canada, what kind of documents did you come with? Was it a passport?
Well, actually I had the Yugoslav passport.
That family. You stayed
I stayed there. Actually, I stayed there, and also I became a Yugoslav citizen, you know, because of that. After a while, you know, I became a citizen, you know, I served in the army, but, you know, I served my, you know, I did my dues, not regular, but on the temporary, you know, they called me, I went over there. So I got my passport, and when we applied, that was, we applied over there, we paid to everything, you know, except, you know, that was, we called upon my wife's brother, you know.
So you applied to come to Canada?
Yeah.
To the embassy yourself?
Yeah.
Your brother didn't sponsor you?
No, no, not really, we applied. Actually, and I was, you know, well, I wouldn't call it smart enough, even though I knew something about it. Actually, I arranged all those documents. For example, I became a member of the Association of the Engineers of Ontario when I was back in Macedonia. Mm-hmm. I applied, I paid $15, I remember today, $15, I became a member. When I came here, then again I had to go, you know, to apply to nostrificate, they call it, nostrification.
Certificate.
To recognize my diploma from Poland. Because in Canada, after the Second World, there were quite a big Polish colony. There were some Polish people in the engineering business, in the government. So the Polish, the certificate issued by Poland were respected well. Mm-hmm. But the question is, they called me over there to the from the association, and I had, you know, an interview basically before they, whether they accept you or give you to put some additional exam, things like that. But I passed that thing, you know, successfully, and I had only about 2 hours, you know, interview with those engineers over there. And after that, they granted me, you know, the rights to practice the civil engineering.
So they recognized your diploma?
Yeah, they recognized my diploma. I still have it hanging my wall at home.
Great. And what did you do in Canada then? Did you start working?
I started to work as a draftsman because, you know, I could do that. Even though I could not speak properly, you know, but I could do that, you know, with simple words like that. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, before I came to Canada, you know, I started teaching myself by myself. There was an Asimil method called. I bought a book over there, and before I came, you know, I went through that.
You taught yourself
a few lessons. Well, actually, the question is, when you took a lesson from the official like that, it's boring. It goes nowhere. I've taken a better way. I bought myself a book, English book, and I started with the first letter. The explanation, I went, you know, with the dictionary, find the word, and whenever I had problems, I went to inspect, you know, the grammar about it, and slowly I started with the first letter. The first page was, you know, all written on top of that with the explanation. By the time I went to the last page, I was almost gone through knowing all of it without any mistakes.
Wow, so taught yourself.
I taught myself, and when I was coming here to Canada, I remember there was a problem with the transportation. The plane had a problem, so they let us stay, and then they sent for Pan Am, I think there was now the company doesn't exist, the American company, they went. So they had an American crew, nobody spoke the English at that time, and I had with us small children, you know, and I was waiting and got the worst seats at the back. But I was happy because I had my dad. Because I knew a few words, you know, and I've spoken to the stewardess, you know, a few in English. And she was so happy, she said, "Oh, there is one who speaks English." And I said, "Sorry, but I don't." I said, I read a few, I know a few words, but I didn't know the pronunciation. You know, it's not just as simple that. I just knew the meaning of it. I could explain, but it was far from knowing how to pronounce and do like that. But that was, you know, things that go along. And because of that, they've given my children toys to play with the plane, you know, and they sat behind us, and we got a good time. In a bad time, basically, because we had to stay one day extra.
You made the best of it.
Yeah.
Because of your language skills. Good for you. Yeah. And Risto, when you came to Canada, then you started to work as an engineer?
As a draftsman.
As a draftsman?
I worked for about, that was my luck, as I said, like that. I went, when I started looking for a job, and it was then a luck. I was living here on Eglinton, and I said I'm gonna start from the Eglinton, from the Yonge Street, you know, eastwards, and I taken from the Yellow Pages all those companies which associate with like that. And there was, I went over there. There was a Polish fellow. And there was a Polish fellow who went, you know, from the Second War. He went to fight Germans, and he went from there to France. From France, he came to Canada, and he was like that. And I went to him, and we started speaking, you know, Polish, and he needed a resume. I said, "The hell, you know." So I got my
first job in Canada.
First job, first try, as a matter of fact.
First try.
And I got the job. Except, you know, it was very bad, you know, very low paid job, you know. Mm-hmm. I remember that time, it was 1974, I had a $10,000 a year salary.
You had?
$10,000 a year salary.
$10,000 a year
Yeah,
salary.
At that time was, you know, very low. But in a way, that was the beginning, you know. I worked for him for about 1 year or so, and then he had to close because I was left the only one. He was the boss and I was the employee. So he says, "Sorry, but I cannot afford you anymore." So, but then again, after 2 months, I find another, or 2 weeks, I find another job. And could you just imagine, that job, you know, that lasted a year, I don't know how, very short period of time, they went, you know, down. There was, if you remember, that was 1974, you know, that was the crisis.
The economic crisis.
It was very difficult. So they went. There was a big company, Procter & Rutherford, it was, you know, big company, and it went like that. I think they let me go. I don't think so they went down, you know. They reduced like that. They still do exist, but I was out. Then I found another drafting job in a company that I was later on. The company, I started over there, and they got to know me that I'm engineer, and they had an opening for engineer, but they didn't want to hire me. So what they did, you see, that's what it is. They hired one engineer from Russia. He couldn't do the job. They find another one from somewhere else, stayed one day, they couldn't do it. And there was, see, that comes the luck, what you said. There was a engineer, Ukrainian engineer, but he graduated in Poland, so he could speak Polish. And he told the boss later on, he says, "Guys," he told the boss, he says, "you are looking for an engineer, the one for, and you've got one here who knows the business." Mm-hmm. So after 1 year or something like that, they hired me as an engineer, you know. They didn't do, but once I started then I stayed there for about 15 years until they closed the company, you know, and I kind of grew up with it. So. Mm-hmm.
And while you were in Canada, you were busy with your young family and working hard. I know that you got involved in the community quite quickly. Can you tell us about your involvement and the Ditsa Begeltsi, how the group started?
Well, basically that was, I could call it the best time in my life, you know. The other one, the profession, the family, that's a normal thing, you know, you go by. But the question is when we got together and when you find similar souls, you know. And when you share the same history, same ideology, same background, everything else, you know, that makes you to join, to do something, you know. In particular, you know, there was one saying that I've learned in Poland. Basically, there was one Polish poet who says, if you know the value of something, in order to value that, you have to lose it. When you lose it, then you know how much it is worth to you. You know, it's a different way to saying that. So when we got over here, we've got, you know, we have lost, you know, our language and things like that, and we were, and the country as well. And because of that, because of those elements, they made us to think similarly, to become patriots, to become people who love the language. That's why I love my Macedonian language. And this is the first thing that I started when I came here, when I joined the United Macedonians, I offered them to help with the language because there was no newspaper. And I said, guys, why don't we have a newspaper? And they were so smart, they said, well, why don't you do it? Well, basically, because...
So, tell us about that. You, when you came in 74, you joined the United Macedonians right away? Any other organization? Churches?
Right away, yeah. Yeah, in churches as well. That goes to St. Clement, you know.
So you went to St. Clement,
St. Clement, and I joined over there, the United Macedonians. And that's how they came with the idea with that newspaper. Actually, there was... At that time, there was a Macedonian community. We organized a protesting march before the Bulgarian and the Greek embassies. And I said, why don't we make a newspaper or something to advertise it, to do something like that? Well, they say, okay. And I've taken that on myself, and I did make a pamphlet. I organized that with the difficulties on my diet, because there was a magazine, you know, like, and the first page, I was kind of funny. I made three parts of a circle, but separated like that. And I made a big circle on top of that. And that symbolized the three parts of Macedonia, but united. Mm-hmm. Yes. That was the name. You know, when I went to the committee of the United Macedonians, and there were quite a few people over there, they started, you know, there were some people who were pro-Bulgarian oriented because of the first immigration that came to Canada. They were sympathetic with the Bulgarian idea. They were going to the Bulgarian church, learning the Bulgarian language, thinking that's Macedonian as well. You know, even today, when you go through the history of MPO, you find out, you know, some souls like that kind of misplaced themselves. So they said, unacceptable. So I had to change
it. But they were Macedonians. They were Macedonians. First people that they were started
Macedonians.
The MPO,
yeah, they
right?
were Macedonians. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I changed slightly, you know, but it came out. And then they asked me to do the paper. So I organized. I taken those. There were four of us at that time, you know, Vasco Pancharos at the time, man, Georgi Plukovsky, Simon Miloševski, and myself. Mm-hmm. But since I was engineer, you know, I know how to arrange, design, how to contact, how things like that. So I've taken that for myself. They offered to help, so we divided, you know, the work, and we've managed to organize it. And we had to, you know, going with that. I don't know if you remember Spiro Vasilevsky, you know,
the name is very familiar.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He was one of the leaders of the Macedonian immigration over here. He was retired at that time. He was with the old age over here. And I remember, because he was editor of a newspaper before, a few years back, and I've heard about it, so I went to him, you know, with a friend, and said, can you help us? Well, tell us what to do. And he started, well, he says, you're going to do that on this page, that, on this page, that, like that. I look at him, I said, listen, I don't want you to tell me what to write. I want you to tell me how to do the paper. And that's when we separated ourselves from that, I said, because, you know, that's it. So I've taken that on myself, and I went, we organized that. We've got difficulties, but we organized that.
So you started the newspaper?
We started the newspaper, and we started very difficult because, you know, you have to type it. We didn't have. So I went.
What was it called in the beginning?
Makedonski glas.
United Macedonian paper, Makedonski glas.
Yeah, it was Makedonski glas, not United Macedonian. It was by them, we call it, but it was Magellan's Igloo. So what happened?
Was it monthly or once a year?
Monthly.
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 Okay.
Monthly it was. But in order to type that, we went, there was at that time the Serbian newspaper Naše Novine. And because we use the same alphabet, so we assumed that they have, you know, all the... So we went over there, so they typed us, you know, that text. And that's how we made, you know, the first, what we've done is, it's not just to make a newspaper, you know. I had to make the, everything, all sorts. I had to learn it by myself, but I did it anyway. So we went over there, they brought us the type, but they went over and changed the mistakes they made, you know. So we had the mistakes, going back to them, and they corrected, and then I got to cut things, you know, like, but we managed to do that. I'm going to tell you how difficult it was. After they've learned, you know, they invited me at one time to join them, you know, they had some conference. And I went over there, I told them, listen guys, I am from Macedonia, but I'm Macedonian. Our newspaper is for all of Macedonia, which is in the Republic, in the Yugoslavia, in Greece and Bulgaria. I said, our idea is for all those Macedonians. It does not drive with the Yugoslavian because they were, you know, Macedonian, they were by Serbian, and they meant, which is Serbian, it's Yugoslavian, it's ours. That was the policy. I said, we do not accept that idea of, and they cut us off.
They didn't like that.
They didn't like it. So what happened, what we've done, you see, then we went, there was Sotirovsky, I don't know if you can remember the name Sotirovsky, there was a guy who was editing in Detroit, a newspaper like that. We figured he knows, so we did. We prepared all the materials. You know, if you talk to George Plukowski about that, and he was kind of, he had more time. So he drove from here to Detroit. They typed it. He went to break over here. We changed the mistakes. He went back over there to change them. And that's how it took so much effort and, you know, to make up. So later we decided at that time, then we started doing things like that. We made that to be part of the United Macedonians, because when I took it on myself, I said, I'm not going to make it my paper, because it's not going to be successful. And if it's not with the United Macedonians, I don't want it, because I want people to read it, not just to go for personality or to make money on it. No. So I made it for the United Macedonians. And at that time, we paid, you know, we placed some ads in it, and they had to pay for it. So we started to getting some money. So what we've done, we, at that time, you know, I'm talking about 75 or 6, something like that.
1975.
And it was, we bought for the first computerized machine, you know, with a Cyrillic on it for $10,000. That was big money at that time. We bought that.
Was it a big machine?
It was a big machine, yeah. And in addition to that, we have found a girl. She was from Republic of Macedonia. She came over here, but she knew how to type. So we paid her. So she typed over here. So we finally managed to get all the elements in one place, and we've been successful. But we've been editing for about 3 years or so every month. Then of course some disagreements we have had, you know, because it's one thing to write a paper, but you have to have, you know, a successful audience. You've got people to read it, to participate. And the United at that time, they didn't quite do well, you know. So it was so much so that you can imagine that at one time we had to pay all the expenses for the Illingen picnic. They didn't have the money to pay for it. We paid from the newspaper. And there were people from the newspaper, they were against me at that time. I didn't want to mention people who are, because it doesn't really make the difference. The only thing made difference that it was not fair, you know, to go against, you know, like they give you an article, said, I'll give you the article, but you have nothing, you haven't got the right to change it. Nothing. I said, to hell, if it, like that, I do not accept. It's got to be written to begin with in a proper Macedonian language. I'm not going to change your ideas behind. I'm going to make it only printable. He said, no, don't keep it. You know, and they went, oh. But anyway, I edited at the beginning for every month, then we went every 3 months, then half, and then I decided that's it, you know, it doesn't pay anymore to continue with it. I think about 5 years I stayed with the paper, you know, like that, and we've done quite a bit of a job at that time, you know. I'm going to tell you the reaction. There was a friend of ours in Republic of Macedonia, and when we printed that, we had a list that we sent. We sent to Republic of Macedonia, to the museum over there, to the historical society over there, you know, like we supplied everybody. And when he saw it over there, and one comment was like that, your newspaper was greeted like a raqueta. How do you call it? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Like a rocket.
Like a rocket. It was, you know, so
positively accepted,
you know, as such, okay. Like that. So that was it. But what happened is that was the beginning of the Association of Decibels in that paper. The four of us, later called, they call it, you know, Gorsko Nachalstvo, they call it us, you know, because we were, you know, on top of things. We started.
Can you tell us what that means, Gorsko Nachalstvo?
Gorsko Nachalstvo, it means that during the war with the Germans, the partisan, they had the top command, and that was called Gorsko Nachalstvo. So there was the top board or whatever you call it.
Executive.
The top executive of the partisan, because that was in the Gora, it means it's a mountain.
In
you
the
know.
Mountain. Yeah. Yes.
So that's was the idea.
The mountain. Yeah. Yes.
And that was called like that, and we started doing that. We organized, and then once we organized that, you see, that's what develops. When you start going into something, before you go to know something, you have a vague idea as to what it is. But once you start building it up, then you start seeing things, you know, that otherwise previously you didn't see it. So by doing that, we saw many things. First of all, we got organized. We got to promote our language and culture, which was, you know, very good thing. Then by doing that, we got involved into things like politics, the national politics, and things like that. And one thing I'm going to tell you, when you organize the association, you know, because I was, you know, in charge, I was all the time because of my position like that, you know. And we had one sentence that I said, you know, at that time. I said, in our association, we will make no difference between the religion, people, what it is, between the politics, where they are, you know, like that, as long as somebody is declaring that he is Macedonian, he is welcome to be part of us. That's why at the beginning we had quite with Petr Vasilis, he was, you know, from the Republic of Macedonia. Petr Ginevski was a member at the beginning of that. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, basic to that. And one more thing that made us being accepted by just about everybody, and nobody could say a word against us, we put the human rights as a basic for our existence, for human rights. Human rights. So nobody at that time, that was popular, nobody could say nothing wrong about that. Not Greeks, not Yugoslavs, not Canadians, nobody could say nothing wrong, because human rights, it's a basic thing that United Nations stands by, you know, that was built on that. So we keep on doing that. That's why nobody could say anything wrong about us. We at that opened our village, our doors to being accepted by then Yugoslavian government. We've been accepted by that, you know, that was, I'm gonna tell you one thing. At that time, the Yugoslavian, they had, by constitution, by their right, they did not accept any kind of association like that in their country. We were the first one accepted. Why? Because, you know, we've taken the ambassador here in Toronto, and we talked to him, and he said, our basic thing is human rights. We've got nothing else on our agenda. That's the only thing. He transferred that to the Yugoslav government, and then they let us, you know, and they let us actually organize similar association in the Skopje. That was the idea of that. You know. Mm-hmm. We organized after that throughout the world. We've organized first in Skopje, then there was about three committees in Australia. There was in Melbourne and Adelaide and Perth. And then we organized those people in the Europe, you know, states like in Poland and mm-hmm. things like that. So that became a huge thing, you know.
It all started from the four people who were involved in starting the newspaper, Three Dime Macedonians. So tell us how that happened. It was yourself, the four people that involved right from the beginning, and how you then started the Decibelci
Association. Yeah, basically the four of us that were, you know, Vasco Pancharovski, that was one.
And where was he educated?
He was in Czech.
He was
older than us. I just mentioned before that he was the teacher. You know, he was taught a Macedonian language. So in our newspaper, he was the language editor. Mm-hmm. Then it was George Plukowski. He was educated in Poland, you know. Then he moved to Macedonia before that. So he moved over here.
Did you know George from Macedonia?
I knew him, you know, like that, but...
Not well.
I knew better his older brother, you know, things like that, but I've seen him, you know, like that. So, and he was actually good in writing. So he was the writing editor, mm-hmm. he said like that. Then was Simeon Miloševski, you know, he was good with money. Oh, he was very, very detail-oriented. I mean, he could count pennies, you know, like that. So he was looking after the after the budget.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I was the chief in charge, you know, the editor of that.
And when did you get motivated to start an actual association? How did that happen? After the newspaper?
Well, we've got, you know, it's difficult, you know, what happens, you know, this history, always a history behind something like that. There were some people that got the idea that to organize a reunion of the people from Poland. And they used to call we Polacy, me the Polish, you know, like that. Because and then they were us generally to begin, but then they were Greek as well is involved in that. So we got together and we organized a first reunion of like that. We made like that.
Here in
Toronto. And that was in the plaza which was on Eglinton and Birchmont, you know, that where we later organized our first reunion. That was small, about 70-80 people. So
you remember the restaurant?
That was East End or something like restaurant. It was in the basement. I don't remember now.
In Birchmont and Eglinton.
Yeah. So that was there when we met. So after we got to talk, I said, you know, because the idea was can you imagine what happens during that first reunion? We promoted Macedonian, you know. But then the orchestra who played like that, somebody asked a Greek song to be said. And there was a comment from one of them. Now is our song coming, you know, like that. Because it was a Greek one, you know. And that kind of hurts you badly, you know, because we grew up together and all of a sudden they get the idea. Most of us Macedonians, we speak Macedonian, and now all of a sudden the Greek one is our song, you know. That kind of makes you think twice about to accept whom you should call a friend, whom you don't have to, or you shouldn't call a friend, you know. And that's the idea came, you know, that we got to understand that we should do it for ourselves. And we decided that since we were doing that, and in addition to that, there was another thing that happened. Afterwards, we organized the first one. See, there were some people that came from Yugoslavia. They called themselves mostly, at that time, if you can remember, the idea was they called themselves Yugoslavs. There were quite a few, and it was, you know, prevailing. And they wanted to organize, you know, just for the children from Yugoslavia.
The Decibelci who were in Yugoslavia.
Yeah. So they wanted a separate to go over there. They even invited me, you know, because it was a guest over there, you know, like that. And we had at that time, I don't want to mention names because that, it's not really mm-hmm. useful. They invited, and that's what they started, you know, like that. And they started Serbian song, you know, to sing on that, you know, like that. The idea for us getting together in that newspaper was to promote the Macedonian culture, Macedonian song and dances and people and everything else, you know, because our culture, our history is different than those ones here. So we need to do that. And we have decided that, no, we are not going to do that. We're going to go for our own. I remember that because when we discussed that, I don't know who proposed it, but it doesn't matter. But we said, in all our reunions, there will be no songs of Greek nature, Bulgarian or Serbian. Why? Simply because they were participants when they divided Macedonia. They've taken the rights of our people away. So we are not going to afford them, you know, their songs. We're not going to do that. And we, till the end, when we organized about 20, we've got the last one was 20 reunions, never allowed a strange, you know, song from those countries to be played. Not because we don't like, everybody can like their own, you know, they can do it at home, you know, but not in official capacity, not with us disabled. You know, by having those politics that I mentioned, and it was for a long time now in our history over here in Canada, the Decibels was the most popular organization for the Republic of Macedonia for a long time.
Yes, yes. Can you tell us about your functions and your activities that really stand out in your mind?
Well, first of all, as I said, you know, those two things, that human rights being the basic issue.
Those were your goals.
Yeah, no, those are the basics for
the foundation
for the reunion. Based on that, every year we made a reunion. So we get together, and what happened is we decided to make that reunion for all the disabled, never mind where they are coming from. So from all the countries, whoever feels himself being Macedonian, Detebegalets, or friend to Detebegalets. When we started, we've got a very large audience of people who liked the idea to do that. So, and on those reunions, in addition to that, what we've done, which is...
You had banquets, right?
Banquets. In addition to that banquet, not just banquets, but we invited all the mothers, all those ladies who were taking care of us while we were out there. We invited them, and we, you know, we've given them ceremony special for them, you know, the flowers and the, you know, and they're free to enter, you know, things like that. So we adopted that. And because of that, we started to unite our people. And in addition to that, what it is, they started from here, and the idea we transferred all throughout the world, you know, that's what I mentioned, we organized elsewhere. And by doing that, you wouldn't imagine how much effort we put into it. For example, I went all the way from here to Detroit. There was some function over there. All the way over there to Detroit to invite them to join us for the reunion in 88. That was our pièce de résistance, I call it, the most valuable, important thing that we have created, done. It was in 88, the 4 years after our exodus.
That was in 1988, in Skopje, a reunion for all the Decibelsi to unite and to come to Skopje and celebrate. Tell us about that reunion. What happened?
Well, first, you know, what happened, first of all, because we organize, we invite everybody here in Toronto. We have attended and we invite everybody to join us, the United Macedonian, the churches and things like that. You join us with that reunion. And most of them did respond. They came in big numbers into the Skopje. Mm-hmm. But before that, when we organized it itself, I remember in 84, I went to Macedonia to establish the ideas about it. I went to the government of Macedonia at that time. I don't want to mention whom I have talked to, but the idea was they wanted to say, well, that is not idea, you know. I said, this is Yugoslavia, you know, this is something which is... it has a separatist tendency like that, they're going to create. And I told them at that time, blankly, you know, I said, listen, we're going to make the reunion. We can make it in Toronto, we can choose Paris, for example, or Melbourne, or somewhere in Toronto. But if we do that, the Republic of Macedonia will not be with us. it won't be in Macedonia. Now, can you decide that for yourself, not to be in Macedonia, a Macedonian event of that importance? They gave us the green light in 84. And in 84, we started to prepare for the reunion in 88. And for that, just to make how important was that, first of all, through the embassy, we kind of, when we send the message, you know, we let them know who we are, so they knew who they are dealing with. In addition to that, that information, they went to the Greek government. And I've got the information from the sources that are secure and that you could believe on. They were Greeks, they have sent two delegations to the Belgrade to cancel that reunion.
To cancel it.
They wanted to cancel because it was not to their politics, you know. They didn't want to do that. They didn't want to open up problems like that, you know. So that was, so that's how it happened to be in Skopje. So we have very, very, sometimes very difficult argument, you know, to resolve along the line, because there were in the government people who didn't like the idea, because that even though Yugoslavia was, you know, they call it halfway, you know, between the West and the communist countries at that time, but they still had communists sitting there on their leading position, so they had to decide. So they had heavily influencing on everything was what was done. For example, the newspaper Nova Macedonia, it's New Macedonia, there was done by a fellow who was sympathetic even from our part of Macedonia, you know. He was the chief in charge of that. And we had the most problem with him, you know. He at one time, there was a meeting that we had over there, like that. He stood up, he says, I'm not gonna be part with this anti-Yugoslavian activity, and he walked away. Even though before that he came here to discuss things with us, and we made him ample clear that we are not changing nothing, and we are gonna stand, but that's what happened. When they went over there, when it appeared to be so big, so influential, and I made an interview with one of the editors over there, and he didn't publish it.
He didn't publish it.
And then that fellow, he came when we later met, and he was kind of avoiding me, and I finally said, sorry, he said, that was not my decision, like that. So we've got difficulties, but we have overcome those difficulties, and we were so successful at it. I don't know if you remember, but the vice president of Macedonia at the time of Kiro Grigorov, the first government, was Ristevski, you know, that academic, you know. Mm-hmm. And when he came here, he says, you know, he says, your reunion was like the perestroika and glasnost what destroyed Russia when they came. It was such an important event, you know,
in
Macedonia. If you can connect the dots in there, after our reunion, and I can tell you because I was speaking over there and the interviews and people were coming and congratulations, things like that, and was telling me, you know, that he says, how did you do that? For the first time, and they start to understand that Macedonia in the Aegean part, in Greece, that's Macedonia. That's the Macedonian people. They have woken up on the national idea as a nation. They started to seek themselves, not the Yugoslav, as Macedonian. For the first time after that, and it was not a long time after that, that Macedonia gained his independence. That was in 92, about 4 years after that.
91.
4 years after that, you know, 91.
Three years.
And I don't want to make it too important, but I think that we've made quite a contribution for that to happen, because we let the Macedonians think for themselves, by themselves, for themselves, you know. That is something that happened when we've done that.
When you did the reunion, an important part of the reunion was your effort to go to Macedonia in Greece that's a ability to see their place of birth, their villages. And tell us what happened. You ordered buses full of Macedonians ready to go through the border and visit their villages in Greece, and tell us what happened at the border.
Well, just I'm going to tell you first, and don't tell nobody, but the idea was, when we discussed first the idea of going to the Greece, the people in the government of Macedonia, they said, don't do that. It's dangerous. You shouldn't succeed. We said, we're going to do it, regardless of whatever anybody thinks. We're going to do it. I said, you better be prepared yourself. You know, I know, because I was the one who told them so. And I don't want to say to whom I said, because they were part of the government of Macedonia, so they knew like that. So we decided. So what happens? We've made that to be legally, by all accounts. We have hired an agency to do that, both in Republic of Macedonia and in Greece, to do that, to organize. We didn't go just to one village. We went, you know, like a tour through that part of Greece. So, you know, we didn't associate that. We didn't want to give them, you know, an idea that, well, we are trying to do and advertise, you know, our ideas about it, or to kind of try to transfer, you know, things like that. So we've done that over here, and we prepaid all those things, you know, that's what we've done. And we went over there, and true enough, we've taken Macedonian buses, you know, we went, you know, the history, it's been on that, shown like that, but we went with that bus over there. And when we went to the border, and here starts, you know, the whole thing unveiled, you know, and as it goes, you know, they stopped the bus, you know, at the border. And what happened, the authorities in Greece, they took four of us, you know, the organizer, they know the names, you know, things like that. They took us out with their wives. But look at that, you know, that stupidity, and how people... I had my children on my passport. They were in the bus. So they took us out, and they said, the bus can go. Mm. You see, like that. And but before we went over there, when we had a conference in Skopje, when I told them our plans, you know, like that, you know, they, even though they advised not to go over there, but, you know, I've got the information of them, and I told them, regardless of what happened, if a one person does not get the visa or the go-ahead to go in, everybody goes back, you know. Mm-hmm. I told them that, so they prepared. And when they took us, they wanted, you know, and they took us out, and they took about seven or eight from the border, you know, these people. They put us, you know, in the center. They wanted us to take over here.
Sorry, they put...
They circled us.
They circled,
yes,
the border guys.
Yeah,
the border
they circled us. They wanted us, you know, to move over to border to the outside, so the autobus can go through.
Uh-huh.
And when they started that, and I said, "Stop, guys!" I said to them, "You know, stop." I said to my guys, "Let's go in, bus, back."
You know. Did they give any reason why they took you guys out? Did they talk to you?
No reason. That's no reason. Absolutely.
They just said you cannot go.
Yeah. That's it.
You eight cannot go.
Yeah. So they turn us back, you know, like that. I told them, you know, that was our decision. And that's, I said, because of that, that gained such a popularity. And because of things like that, what we've done, you wouldn't believe what happened. I'm going to jump ahead, you know. When we came back over here, for the first time happened that the Greek embassy or consulate over there, they asked me to come over and to discuss, for the first time that happened, for the Greeks to accept a declared Macedonian and to talk to us like that. And we did that. And we did that, and I think they regretted that the moment we went over there, when we crossed that. Because, you know, they were learned over here, when the Macedonian went to get a visa or something like that, they were the supreme authority. They could say no, yes, and nobody could say nothing to them, you know. That was the idea. When we went over there, the poor ambassador or consul, he could not have had any good argument to say any bad thing about us. We cornered him so much. First time in my life I've seen a diplomat like that. He's got, how do you call it, when he's like a Vesno Kucha, what it is, you know, that, like a
he was foaming at the mouth.
At the mouth, because you see what, when he was talking, he was one of those people who came from Turkey, and he says that all his parents and grandparents came from Turkey. And there was a, you remember that there was in 1982, there was a law in Greece they adopted, they could accept in Greece only Greeks by blood. And when he was talking about that, his parents came from Asia, and I told him, I said, listen, guy, according to that law from 1982, you are not a Greek, you are a Turkish fellow. But I am a Greek because I was, me and my parents, everybody was born in there. That's when I saw that he got so emotionally involved that he couldn't speak, you know, like that. I remember that because at the end of it, you know, it's a long story, but at the end of it, we offered him to have some more discussion. We could invite him to a restaurant. And he said, no such a thing. He was taping the conversation, and he was, most likely he sent it because everybody was listening. And a short while after, he was gone from Toronto, that guy. So my point was about the importance of that 88 reunion. I mean, in many aspects of life on average, or the political, or even economics part of it, you know, it's very important for Macedonia.
And it was advertised, it was on the air, people heard about the Dica Begovci, like you said, for the first time, some Macedonians who didn't have a lot of knowledge.
Yeah, but then we have to go through, as I said, you know, many other things. You know, that time in Macedonia when we went, you see, that's what it is when you go with the politics, you know, things like that. We had a conference over there when I told them that we had independent press conference done by us in Belgrade. And there was a few people, even one stood up, he says, you cannot do that, he says, you know. I said, listen, we are Canadian citizens. We've got the right to do it. Maybe you can apply to US government to reject that, but that's as far as you can go. This is a done deal. I did that a night before it was done like that, you know. And I did that very forcefully. I told them, listen, you guys, you are not going to tell us what to do. We are telling you what we're going to do and how we're going to do it, you know, like that. And we did that. Mm-hmm. We did that over there. The only thing is we've got about 8 or 10 journalists coming. You see what happened at that time was the 4th of July, the United States Embassy invited all the journalists accredited in Belgrade to attend their embassy, you know, they were festive. But we've got about 7 or 8 journalists that came to our conference, you know, like that. And before that, you know, what happened, I'm going to tell you one thing, you know, that's something that only I know. Now you're going to know that. When we finished that, and I don't want to imply, but when we discussed that with the president of Yugoslavia, Nikolic was at that time. He came up, he accepted us, and I brought the question of the Macedonians in the Aegean part having not rights, and I told them, because if in Yugoslavia, if you are Croatian or Serbian, you can get to Greece without any visa. From Macedonia, you had to get visa, and you had to prove that you are born over there to get. If you are Yugoslav citizens like myself, they turn you from the border. And Nikolic, the president at that time, he says, you know, we know that and we try everything to do to prevent that. I told him, listen, maybe you try, but if you try to make them to listen, why don't you make it public so we can support you and everybody else? And that's the discussion ended right there. Mm-hmm. Couldn't go any further. On my way back, I just remember that on my way back, they transferred me with the plane of the government of Macedonia, you know, because there were a few other people over there. And one of the government, he gave me a hand, you know, he squeezed my hand. He says, Risto, do you know what you've done? I said, what did I do? He said, you people, you have opened the door for us so we can go in. We can go in and see things for us, for Macedonians. He tells me, one of the top Macedonian diplomats at that time in the government, you know. So that means I'm trying to explain in many instances or examples how things did develop, you know. Like
it gave the Macedonians in Macedonia more power to ask about the rights of Macedonians.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. And based on that, there was one Macedonian in the Skupština. It was in the Yugoslavia. That was the top class. It went. He was the president of the Democratic Party. Oh, I forgot his name. He went over there, he spoke about us in the Yugoslav Scoops, and it was the top part because of that, you know, things
happened,
developed, mm-hmm. and it, that had influence like that, you know, so. Mm-hmm.
Right, now, Risto, you were the first president of the Decebelci, and are you still president, and how did that go?
Well, actually, the way we are organized on the friendly, you know, like that. Mm-hmm. When we started to make present things like that, I told guys, I said, listen, I can be or somebody else president only when we are not getting together. When it's a official function, then we can send, you know, like that. Mm-hmm. But when we are together, there is no president, no functions, everybody is equal rights, you know, everybody has one vote and things like that. Totally democracy, you know. Mm-hmm. Except, you know, nobody challenged it. The only ones, in 1 year there was one fellow who wanted to try. I told them, you know, everybody who wants the position, let try, you know, like that. It's no question about it. And what we've done, truly democracy at that time, when they invited us, sometimes we decided, okay, we're going to send now this person to represent us.
Different person every time.
Yeah, not every time, but most of the time we had, you know, that kind of a relation. Because, you know, I never had any ambition to be somebody else that I am, you know. My idea was for us to be friends, you know, to behave like once, with full understanding of our goals, you know. If you have enough guts in yourself to call yourself Macedonians, you are welcome to join us, you know. Mm-hmm. Do whatever you
And how has the organization evolved? Presently, what is happening?
Well, presently we are at ease, you know, we are, I would say, dissolved. We still function, but we do not function anymore as that. We don't make meetings, we get together, because most of us are now old people, mm-hmm. you know, we are age now, mm-hmm. we cannot do much, and quite a few of us are already gone from the committee that we were. Vasco Pancharovski, let's say, he's dead, Simon Milosevski is dead, George Plugosic's wife is dead, you know, and so we don't have, you know, that body mm-hmm. anymore. People are now more like grandparents looking after their children. And in addition to that, since the establishment of the Republic of Macedonia as a country, and we've done just about everything we could, you know, to achieve that and to achieve the recognition of that, you know, because as you know, right now the Republic of Macedonia are constantly in connection with the Greeks discussing the name of Macedonia in the future like that. You know, things like that are still going, and now they are part of the Republic of Macedonia. So there is not much we can contribute to enhance there what is already there. But we are here, you know, in if need be, you know, we always respond, we always kind of get together. Mm-hmm. What we've done, you see, one of things that what we've done, for example, because we, in order to properly function in Canada, you need money. So that's why one of the goals for those reunions were to get some money, because when you having money, it's ability to do things, you know, when you do things, then you move forward, you know, things like that. So we had that, but we had adopted something like that. We have, since we've organized ourselves, we've given $1,000 to every church that was established since then in Canada or elsewhere for that matter as well. We have, with that money, we have bought some computers to the school in Macedonia. Lazo oh, I forget the names now. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm age here. Mm-hmm. You know, I can be excused for not remembering all the names, but
Tarkovsky.
He was one of the Macedonian immigrants from our part, which then turned back and contributed to later. Mm-hmm. But there was Lazaro. He was one of the school in Autokomanda is named after him. So we went over there. We equipped with the computers. You know, we've given some money there. We've given money to our church for that small, you know, in the main church in Macedonia. In Skopje, Sveta Maglen, Meglenska, the picture of it. You know, it's we've done that. We helped our church like that, and we've done many other things besides, you know, what that national things we've been doing.
Ovo hramotvo Skopje, in the big church in Skopje, that's also Saint Clement, isn't it?
We've paid for that, you know. We've done many things, you know, associated while doing what we've mm-hmm. done. Question is, what we've done, you know, we personally never gain any money. We've been known, because honesty was the base of our doing so. We paid our own tickets when we organize that, you know, from the committee, we pay. So nobody could say anything, because our people, you know, there are people who understand things and there are people who don't quite get it, you know, or because we are immigrants, so we kind of value the value of the dollar, so everybody looks through it. So nobody could say a word about our, you know,
because... So actually it was all voluntary.
It's all voluntary.
Yeah, I na makedonski se ga može da zbornim nekom na... Беше сето волонтерно од сите луѓе што работеа за...
Апсолутно. Не само волонтерно, ние потрошевме толку пари, сами од своите пари. Спомнам за Георги Плуковски, по 2-3 пати одеше до Детройт. Не побара пари да му се плати ни гесот, ни времето.
Да.
Ние ше ги правиме работите, ше имаме одано овие, како ли кажам, без пари ше ги правиме. Јас кој одев од Детройт, си платив сите тие работи мои што беше. Секаде, сите што дававме, значи, од нас, ни еден финансиски нема профитирано ни еден долар. Све што одеше, што беше собрано, одеше за тие работи. Тоа беше јасна беше ситуација да све што беше за општеството, за нашата комуна, за тие работи, све без пари од наша страна, апсолутно не наплатувавме за ништо во тој однос.
Така, и
можеш
сега да ни кажеш нешто малце за фамилијата? Фамилијата дојде тука во Канада, млада фамилија, и сега имате повеќе членови?
Оја. Mm-hmm. Животот си оди натаму, без разлика. Јас имам две деца. Синот се роди во Полска, како што мен спомнав.
Името?
Керката во Скопје, Филип. И керка ми, Ленче се викаме, Хелена, иначе е крстена, керка во Скопје. А тука е сега, тука доаѓа Канада. Имам невеста од Скотланд, mm-hmm. и со нив имаат два внуци, Филип, и тој на Филип синот, тоа се Александр, знаеш, Филип и Александр, така од таа комбинација. И другата е Британи, тоа веќе доаѓа, знаеш, од мајкава страна доаѓа. А керка ми има арменец,
uh-huh.
значи сега сме ние канадејци. Така.
Мултикултурни во yeah. секој аспект.
No. Канадејци, речево канадејци се разбира.
Сигурно,
да што работата е секој кој се емигрира, бега од нашите места, а е познато тоа дека многу луѓе сакаат да се вратат, не издржаа, многу се враќаат назад. Зашто оваа степен на демократија и слобода што ги уживаме ние тука ги нема никаде. Со ако некој добро му мисли на својата фамилија, ќе ги донеси, ќе ги остави тука да живеат, да се направат живеачка. Што значи тоа? Дека кога веќе ние се бавиме национално, ги изградиме, сакаме да ги научиме наше деца, меѓутоа тие веќе имаат свој ум, своја мотивација и своји табиети, и тие живеат на еден канадски начин. И тоа не само што живеат на канадски начин, али и немаат предрасуди, немаат комплекси на помала вредност. Тие веќе се вредности. Тука се родени, се канадејци по раѓање, и тие се тогашни, и таков еден живот се ствара. Јас би сакал да ги видам нашите да го прават тоа, да бидат канадејци, меѓутоа да не си го заборават своето. Да речеме, кога дојдевме ние од Дунајтон Македонија, се ние пак од деса бегалци, имаме организирано школа, кога немаше во таквото, школа имавме организирано за нашите деца кои сакав, имавме преку 100 деца ни доаѓаат во Иглен и Midland Collegiate Institute, имавме земено, учителка на наша дојде таму, учи, ја две деца се ги пушти таму и се рукуе, и двајца да, се, зборат на скршен македонски јазик, меѓутоа го зборат јазикот и го пишуваат, нели? Ама за внуците тоа не гарантира, тоа е вашка работа.
Ристо, што е тоа што си горд, most proud од сето тоа што ги имаш проживеено?
Целиот живот? Тешка работа. И што да ти кажам, зашто горд сум во тоа што успеав, што се вика, баш од фамилиарниот живот, кој се разбира на чело, се знае таа, меѓутоа успеав да одадам нешто од себе си во корист и во служба на Македонија, на македонската наука, култура, историја, државност, знаеш, и тие работи. И до некаде, знам дека, свесен сум дека, знаеш, овие работи тешко да ги процени човек.
Да.
Зашто, знаеш, друго е кога ние си правиме муабет, сосема трета е кога си на чело на една држава и треба да решаваш за прашања кои се од животен карактер, знаеш. Меѓутоа, имаме наш дел во тоа, во целата оваа работа. Би сакал да мислам дека имаме наш дел. И не е важно тоа колку успеавме, важно е колку самите се осеќавме дека еве, јас, како Ристо, направив и дадов од себе си колку што можев, додека можев. Тоа е нешто што ме држи секогаш кога ќе се најдеме вака со пријатели, зашто многу луѓе сега да речеме ме познаваат поради тоа што имав и настап на телевизија и зборени до друго, ја ќе ми дојдат ќе рече здраво Ристо, ќе погледнам здраво како си, ама иако не знам кој е, значи тоа е, да, ти дава една сатисфакција за што ви гата гледа job well done. За работа добро свршена, верувам дека добра работа свршивме и дека тоа ќе остане. Единствено жално е тоа што не е запишано многу во аналите на историјата, знаеш, ова. Поради тоа што времињата такви доаѓа се вкопува ова со стварањето на македонската државност.
Да.
Или после толку големи страдања, после толку невкусни решенија направени врз нас.
And with all your rich with all your rich experiences, Risto, I know that your advice will be very valuable to the upcoming new generations of Macedonians and to the generations that are older. What would you like to suggest or advise? What advice would you have for the newer generation, like say for your grandchildren, upcoming?
Yeah, I know what you mean. Well, basically, what I'm saying is the one thing that everybody sooner or later will learn: look up your roots, be faithful to your roots, get to know them, and behave accordingly. That's the message that I would like to leave. So everybody who has a chance, let it do something, learn about it. If you haven't got the ability to do something, at least learn something, get to know, and be part, I would say, try to be part of the Macedonian community here in Toronto, in Canada for that matter as well.
That's really wise advice. Thank you so much for sharing your life story, sharing your experiences with us. I've really enjoyed listening to all the information you shared with us, and we appreciate having you here.
Yeah.
Thank
well,
you.
Well, I hope somebody along the line listening and watching this video can learn something from it. Well, if